الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وفقها في الدين يا رب العالمين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما، وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما، ولا تجعل فينا ولا معنا شقيا ولا مطرودا ولا محروما. اللهم افتح علينا بحكمتك وانشر علينا برحمتك يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. We, inshallah, today will take a pause from history, from studying the life of the Imam, the great Imam Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man, radiallahu anh. And the reason being is we got to the point where we study the school of Abu Hanifa, madhhab Abu Hanifa. كيف يختلف مذهب أبو حنيفة عن غيره؟ What is the differences between the school of Abu Hanifa from other schools? Why were there so much differences or so many madhahib to spring out in that particular time? You know, all these madhahib came out over almost within less than a century time frame. And to understand that, I felt it's very important that we take a stop and study some of the basics of jurisprudence or mabadi al-fiqh. And in this, I don't mean in any way that we will be going deep into the jurisprudence schools or to go into the study of jurisprudence itself. It is just what's enough for somebody like myself, a layman, to understand about the different schools of fiqh, different schools of jurisprudence, and the different terminology that is used. Because if we start saying that Abu Hanifa favored istihsan and Shafi'i did not like istishab and other things like that, then we will not really understand the differences between these great imams if we don't understand the terminology, if we don't understand the language they had, and don't understand what it means. And why, there are many questions that will come up, is why do we have, in the first place, why do we have madhahib? Why do we have schools? Why do we have different schools? Do we have to have different schools? Why did it happen? What are the differences between them? And without learning the ABCs of jurisprudence, without learning the alphabetical basics of jurisprudence, is going to be very hard to understand that and to continue to know the differences in the lives of these four imams. So that's why, inshallah, today we will stop and we will speak a little bit for a session, or maybe two. We'll take our time, inshallah, doing that, about the basics of jurisprudence. And the first thing that we need to understand is it is really an obligation of every Muslim to at least understand the basics, to understand the ABCs of this knowledge, and to know what is in it for him and what is the religion, how the religion is based on that. So first we start with the definition. What is fiqh? What does it mean? And jurisprudence is obviously not the exact translation, not the literal translation of the word fiqh. The word fiqh in the language means understanding. Literally means understanding. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, قَالُوا يَا شُعَيْبُ مَا نَفْقَهُ كَثِيرًا مِمَّا تَقُولُ. Oh Shu'aib, we don't understand a lot of things you say. Al-fiqh meaning al-fahm, understanding. فَمَا لِهَؤُلَاءِ الْقَوْمِ لَا يَكَادُونَ يَفْقَهُونَ حَدِيثًا. In Surah An-Nisa, what about these people? They can't understand what is said to them. And Musa alayhi salam said, وَحْلُ الْعُقْدَةً مِنْ لِسَانِي يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي. And take away my stuttering or my speech impediment so they can understand, what I said. So this is the word fiqh, came in Arabic language as understanding. Imam Abu Hanifa defined it in a very short, but really it's an all-encompassing definition of the word fiqh. He said, الفقه معرفة النفس ما لها وما عليها. It is for somebody or someone or a soul to understand its rights and its obligations. Fiqh is for someone to understand his right or her rights and obligations. And it is the practical aspect of our Sharia. the practical aspect of our religion is in the practice of fiqh, in jurisprudence. Imam al-Shafi'i gave, radiallahu anhu, gave a great, great definition of al-fiqh. He said about al-fiqh, and this definition, every single word in that definition actually has meaning. And when you go to the book of the fiqh, the explanation of that one line takes pages upon pages, if not chapters, just to understand how Imam Shafi'i, and he, by the way, was one of the first imams to actually write the principles and the basics of jurisprudence. And that happened when one of his students, they had, like we have today, students come from abroad, sit with them and study on them, and they go back and they become imam in their own domain. So he started trying to give rulings on certain issues, the student of Imam Shafi'i, but he could not understand the methodology of Imam Shafi'i. He knew that Imam Shafi'i said this about that, but he wanted to know the methodology of that extrapolation. So he sends an Imam Shafi'i, he said, tell me how do you do that? Tell me how do you reach these rulings? And Imam Shafi'i sent him back a letter, and this letter is called Ar-Risala. Means it's called the letter. And that is one of the first books of basics and principles of jurisprudence. So I digressed a little bit, but the definition of Imam Shafi'i of the knowledge of jurisprudence, he said, الفقه هو العلم بالأحكام الشرعية العملية المكتسب من أدلتها التفصيلية. What does that mean? He said, it is the knowledge of the rulings of religion or jurisprudence that is practical, the practical knowledge of jurisprudence, which is acquired from the detailed evidence. What does that mean? He said, العلم بالأحكام الشرعية العملية المكتسب من أدلتها التفصيلية. العلم, number one, is that means that to understand with great confidence and to know with great certainty. Al-ahkam al-shar'iyya, al-ahkam, it's al-hukm, it's whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ruled, meaning to understand, to try to get an understanding of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave as a ruling in this particular matter. Al-ilmu bil-ahkam al-shar'iyya, shar'iyya, that is something related to sharia, something related to religion. It's not about astronomy or mathematics or biology. This jurisprudence is, this fiqh is related only to ahkam al-sharia. Al-amaliyya, it has to be practical and related to al-amal. Word amaliyya in Arabic language means practical, but the root of it is al-amal. So meaning, these rulings and this knowledge is related to something you do. It's practical, it's your deed, it's things that you do. Whether that deed is in the heart, whether it's something in the heart, or it is something that you actually perform outwardly. Al-muktasab. Something applicable to daily living. Jazakallah khair. Al-muktasab, it has to be acquired, and it is extrapolated. It's extrapolated from what? From what he said, the last word in that definition, min adillatiha al-muktasabu, min adillatiha al-tafsiliya. It is extrapolated, it's taken out from the evidence, the detailed evidence, the references, the resources that we have in our religion. And we will go about that. But the Prophet ﷺ mentioned the word fiqh in his hadith. This was not an innovation. It was not something that just came up in the second century after the hijrah of the Prophet ﷺ. Rasulullah ﷺ, on the authority of Abu Dawud, he said, نَضَّرَ اللَّهُ مْرِئًا سَمِعَ مِنَّا حَدِيثًا فَحَفِظَهُ حَتَّى يُبَلِّغَهُ فَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ أَفْقَهُ مِنْهُ وَرُبَّ حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ لَيْسَ بِفَقِيهٍ. So see the word faqih and fiqh, how many times mentioned in this hadith. The Prophet ﷺ said, may Allah reward or make the life beautiful or fruitful for a person who heard from me a hadith, who heard saying from me, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, فَحَفِظَهُ, he memorized it, حَتَّى يُبَلِّغَهُ, until he delivered that hadith or transmitted this hadith, transmitted this knowledge to somebody else. And then he said, فَرُبَّ حَامِلَ فِقْهٍ, حَامِلِ فِقْهٍ, maybe somebody who actually carries that knowledge or transmit that knowledge, but he doesn't understand it. حامل فقه, but not a faqih. Somebody who can transmit a hadith, tell you the prophet said so, but don't really understand and cannot extrapolate ruling from that hadith itself. Somebody who can carry this knowledge can extrapolate some of it, but the person that he carries it to has more ability. So this is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us, number one, you are not all equal in understanding what I said. And what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying, you will not have the same capability in understanding everything I'm telling you. So transmit it. Take it like the way it is and transmit it, and maybe you will take it to somebody who has more knowledge and more ability to extrapolate the rulings. And this is the definition of al-fiqh. Now, why do we learn fiqh? We learn fiqh so we can practice our religion knowledgeably and in accordance with the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted us to practice this way of life. Because religion is faith. It is something that goes in the heart. And faith itself, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, al-iman ma waqara fil qalb وَصَدَّقَهُ الْعَمَلِ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, faith is what settles in the heart, but it has to be translated into actions. It has to be verified by the actions that a human being does. And to go with the applicable knowledge that with the application of faith, so to speak, we have to understand jurisprudence. And we have to learn the ruling of fiqh and go by it. Now, what is the difference between al-fiqh wa sharia? What is fiqh and what is sharia? And you have this chart, and this will be available, inshallah, on the internet for the slides. Al-fiqh, jurisprudence, which is fiqh, versus religion, which is sharia. Sharia is the religion, or the ruling of the religion, and the form and the creed of the religion. Al-sharia can be creed, which is aqidah, al-aqidah. Faith, which is iman, and conduct, which is our behavior, which is also the way we conduct ourselves and live our life. And it also encompasses the practicality, the things that we do, the practical application of our religion, the way we live our life, how we get married, how we deal with each other, how we deal with each other financially, criminology, law. All of that is all encompasses, because Islam is not only creed, faith, and conduct, it also is a way of life. And to have a way of life ruled by Islam, this all goes into this big category of Sharia. Now, fiqh encompasses only the part that goes in here, which is the practical application of that, of the ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and all the things that we can extrapolate from the sources that we will be talking about. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that there are people who are extrapolators. They take the hadith, and they take rulings from that, and they're called al-mujtahid. And when somebody make ijtihad, they can actually be correct, or they can actually be wrong. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا اجْتَهَدَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَأَخْطَى فَلَهُ أَجْرٌ. If they make a mistake, they still get a reward. And if they do it correctly, do it right, they take two rewards. They take وَإِنْ أَصَابَ فَلَهُ أَجْرًا أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. So of the fiqh, of the jurisprudence, there are actually some correct rulings, but there are some wrong rulings. And the wrong rulings go outside the realm of Sharia. Only the correct rulings of jurisprudence is part of our Sharia. But those things that have been ruled as wrong ruling, later on, that does not go into the Sharia, what we call our religion of Islam. And it is a fact of jurisprudence that there are some rulings that are wrong. And when Imam Malik, radiallahu anhu, would sit down in the mosque of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, fi masjid Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he would be teaching, he would say, kullun yu'khadu minhu wa yuraddu alayhi illa sahibu hadha al-qabr. He said, everybody you take from and you go, you can actually reject some ideas from. Everybody is subject to discussion.
You can argue some rulings with everyone except the honorable owner of that grave next to me, and he used to be sitting in the rawdah of the Prophet ﷺ teaching. He said, everybody you can argue with, everybody you can discuss with except the honorable owner of that grave. And that's why we know that there are some wrong rulings, and we see sometimes students of great imam differ with that imam on certain things. As time changes, some rulings will change. So that's why jurisprudence is very dynamic. Jurisprudence is a very dynamic knowledge, and it can change with time, except that is, of course, not a very general.
Every single person of us, every single Muslim, relationship of a Muslim with Allah, the relationship of a human being with his or her own Lord, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then relationship of one human being to another human being. And you go into the knowledge of jurisprudence, it's not about the relation of a Muslim to another Muslim. It is about the relation of any human being to another human being, and especially the relationship of Muslims to Muslims and non-Muslims. It controls how we conduct ourselves, our relation with everybody else that walks the face of the earth, and it actually controls, and something that is not on the slide, our relationship to animals, our relationship to nature, our relationship to anything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. So two major categories, ahkam al-ibadat wa ahkam al-ibad. Ahkam al-ibadat, these are the rulings of worship. There is anything related to worship, to acts of worship between a human being and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And these are the rulings of tahara, the rulings of ablution, the rulings of salah. How do we perform our salah? How many rak'ah? What is sujood as-sahu? What is that and what is this? And the rulings of, let us see, al-hajj, the ruling of zakah, and all of this. All of this relationship that controls what we do in our acts of worship, that is one section of jurisprudence. And you see usually the books, the textbooks, the classic textbook of jurisprudence, they all start with that. And you see that most of them start with ahkam al-tahara, starting with the very beginning, how to get ready for salah, how to perform your salah, what will spoil your salah, what will spoil your wudu, what will make your wudu better, what is the sunnah, what is the wajib, and etc., etc. The other thing is the civil affairs, is what controls human relationship. That is civil affairs like marriage, divorce, etc., commercial, how ahkam al-biyu, how we sell it from each other, how we buy from each other, how we rent, how we lend money, borrow money, all of that is also in this. And then the laws of criminology, punishment, law, how to do the civil laws, constitutions. And it also goes into nation to another nation relationship, international affairs. All of that is in that big section of jurisprudence. And I wanted to just have an important disclaimer as we go, before we go into the details of jurisprudence. Great, you know, there is a very nice poem in Arabic, and this is really, disclaimer is for me, and I hope my brothers and sisters also benefit from that. The poem goes, إن كنت لا تدري فإن كنت تدري فتلك مصيبة وإن كنت لا تدري فالمصيبة أعظم. Said, if you know that you're ignorant, then that is a problem. Because you don't know, you know, you don't have the knowledge. If you know that you're ignorant, then you have problems with ignorance. But if you don't know that you're ignorant, if you think you're a knowledgeable person, then that's a disaster. That's really a big problem. And half knowledge is much more dangerous than no knowledge. People that are ignorant and they know that they're ignorant, they don't give ruling about things. They don't have the audacity to start, you know, speaking and giving rulings. But people who think they know are most dangerous because they will start giving knowledge. Like, and I gave a parallel, like, you know, if you teach someone that this is a scalpel and this is a retractor and this is a suture, and they said, okay, well, I'll do heart surgery on you tomorrow. How about that? Because they, now they know the tools. Doesn't work that way. Same thing if you give somebody some boards, nails, and hammer and said, okay, build a house and I'll live in it tomorrow. I'm sure that house will collapse very, very soon. And that's why it's very important as we study jurisprudence, all of us, and I'm starting with myself, to understand what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أجرأكم على الفتوى أجرأكم على النار. Those who dare to give rulings, these are the ones who are daring fire, daring the hellfire itself. Because sometimes we start understanding these principles and then we start giving rulings. Oh, this is good because it's from istihsan. This is good because it's from al-masalih al-mursala. This is, you can do this because, I mean, subhanallah, and this is common, I mean, in this society. You ask somebody about something, they just give you a fatwa. It's very easy to get a fatwa these days. But just be careful who you ask and be sure that you ask somebody who's really knowledgeable, and be careful if you have some knowledge and you're asked about something, because sometimes, subhanallah, and we can fall into this problem. So learning the ABCs of jurisprudence does not really make anyone a mufti, does not give anyone the right to give fatwa. Inshallah, I will give a historical perspective about how jurisprudence developed. Why do we have knowledge of fiqh? How did it develop into a branch of Islam that is of highly specialized and highly structured? And we have great wealth of heritage, great wealth of literature, great wealth of tradition that is really of great importance for Muslims to understand. And it is really the envy of many other nations because of its great structure and the great scholars that worked hard on that. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the point and the major source of tashri', the major source of jurisprudence when he was alive. After the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is most of what I'm going to say in this historical perspective is taken from a great book about the different groups that came out of Islam. This book is called Al-Milal wal-Nahal. It's called the different groups, the different things that came out of Islam, and this is by Shahrastani. The Shahrastani says after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam died, the Sahaba found themselves facing a new world. They were coming out of Arabia. They were encountering new situations. They were encountering new people. They were going into Persia. They were going into North Africa. They were going into the heart of Byzantium. And they found events and things that did not occur to them, to the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was alive. So what they did is they would go back to two things. They would go back to the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they tried to extrapolate, and of course they had the ability and the teaching and the training because of their contact with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be able to do that. And they understood Quran more than anybody else. They knew exactly how these verses were revealed, why it was revealed, how it was revealed, what was the circumstances when it was revealed. So they would go back to the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if they don't find exactly what they want, then they had what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them. So they asked each other if they heard anything from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about certain thing. So they already established by that time the two main sources of Sharia, the two main sources of fiqh, which is the Quran, the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if they could not find any of that, then of them there were some mujtahideen. Of them, there were people that actually started giving rulings. And some of them, they started giving some rulings, like Abdullah ibn Umar was one of the fuqaha of the Sahaba, Abdullah ibn Abbas, and Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud had a great school fuqa, and of that school fuqa came Ibrahim al-Nakhai, and later on Hamad ibn Sulaiman, who was the teacher of Abu Hanifa. So they started having their own schools of fuqa, so to speak, but it was not really an organized and structured. And it is from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and from the Sunnah of his companions, and especially al-Khulafa al-Rashideen. Like Umar ibn al-Khattab wrote to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari to give him instructions about how to go about things that are not known to him. He said, "Al-fahmu al-fahm fima talajlaja fi sadrik mimma laysa fi kitabin wala sunnah." اعرف الأشباه والأمثال وقس الأمور على ذلك. He said, you have to have a great understanding of all these doubts and things that you have in your heart and your chest, if it's not in the book or the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then bring comparisons. And that is one of the sources of Sharia, al-qiyas. Al-qiyas, this is what Umar said. اعرف الأمثال والأشباه وقس الأمور على ذلك. He said, learn to bring comparisons of things that you know about. If there is an event that happened on the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it's a similar event, then bring the two together and compare them and see if you can extrapolate a ruling like that. So they started having other sources of Sharia that started springing up at the time of the Sahaba. And they were very, very careful, like we said, when they were giving these rulings. Number one, they will not call it the ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When somebody asked Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, هَذَا حُكْمُ اللَّهِ Is this, when you've given me this fatwa, is this حُكْمُ اللَّهِ Is this the ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And then Abu Mas'ud, he said, أَقُولُ هَذَا بِرَأْيِي فَإِنْ كَانَ صَوَابًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَإِنْ كَانَ خَطَأً مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ فَمِنِّي وَمِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ He would say, this is my opinion. Don't put the name of Allah over my opinion. You have to know what you're dealing with. He said, this is my opinion. If it was correct, then the gratitude goes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if it wasn't, it's from me and from shaitan, from Iblis. So they would not put the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on rulings that they have came up with and they have extrapolated. And then after that, one important thing I also wanted to mention that they wanted to speak a lot of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because that was their mission in life. On the other hand, they were very careful not to give a lot of opinionated things that they don't know much about. So it was very hard to get the Sahaba to give a fatwa. And it is known in Medina that a man came with a question to Medina and he would go, Medina was filled with Sahaba, especially in the time of Umar ibn Khattab, who did not allow the Sahaba to get out of Medina much, especially those who are of knowledge, so they can preserve the wealth of the Islamic heritage and knowledge. And they would go to one Sahaba, he said, no, go to the other one, and they will make a full circle and they go back to the first one they asked and they will not get an answer because of the Sahaba were very reluctant to actually give a ruling that they're not 100% certain of. Then, after the generation of the Sahaba, came the generation of At-Tabi'een, came the generation of the followers of the Sahaba. Now, these are people who did not meet with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they met with his students. They met with the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At that time, there were a lot of changes that were blowing through our ummah, blowing through our nation. And one of it was the fitna, the tribulation that divided this ummah and got into the core of a lot of things about the jurisprudence and religion. And people started going into Sunnah, Shia, followers of Al-Khawarij, Al-Azariqa, Al-Ibadiyya, Al-Ajarida, Al-Mu'tazila. They started, many groups started coming out of the Muslim body. And people started doing something very dangerous that did not happen in the age of the Sahaba. And that is falsifying and creating hadith and given it to the and say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that. This was not known for the Sahaba for obvious reasons. If somebody dared to say something that is false upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sahaba would know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't say so. And if somebody said haddathani nafi'an an ibn Umar, well, ibn Umar was alive, so they would go ask him, is this true? Is this what you heard from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So telling lies at the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not very common at the time of the Sahaba, but it started becoming more at the time of At-Tabi'een. Started really coming up at the days of At-Tabi'een. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, when that happened, radiallahu anhu, we remember at the year 100 of Al-Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he started writing down. He asked Al-Imam Zahri to start writing down the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with its body text of the what is called Matn al-Hadith, which is it's the words that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and with the sanad, with the reference of the hadith. We have to know who said that. Of course, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he said it to who? Who was present? Who was it transmitted to? And how it got to the person that is teaching that hadith? And you have to know every single person. And a new science came out, new knowledge came out called ilm al-rijal or ilm al-tabaqat. You have to know if you said so upon so upon so, then you have to know every single one of them. And they had strong sanad and weak sanad and muqatta' sanad and hadith ahad or hadith mutawatir and etc. And we will talk about that inshallah in more details. And they had some chains that are very well authenticated. There was one chain that they called the chain of gold. They call it, it's very, very strong chain. They call it the chain of gold. And that is Malik an Nafi' an Ibn Umar. عن الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم إمام مالك عن نافع إمام نافع عن ابن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما. This is, they call this the chain of gold. If you know that this hadith was transmitted this way, take it home, take it to the bank. This is a very strong hadith, and they go from there. And then this came to the time of the imams, which are the followers of the followers, or tabi'i at-tabi'een. There were, a lot of them took their knowledge from at-tabi'een or their students. Like Imam Abu Hanifa, his teacher was Hamad ibn Sulaiman, who is a student of Ibrahim al-Nakhai, who is a student of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Now Abdullah ibn Mas'ud is a sahabi, Ibrahim al-Nakhai is a tabi'i, Hamad ibn Sulaiman is tabi'i at-tabi'een, and then his student is Imam Abu Hanifa, radiallahu anhu. But at that time, two main schools, and this is the first time that you can start seeing that there are actually ways of extrapolating rulings from the book and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and things started coming out. Two major schools started taking shape and form. And one school started being called Madrasatul Athar. Al-Athar is textual evidence. Is I take nothing unless you give me a reference that either the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said so, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said so in his book. Is there will be no ruling unless you give me evidence, great evidence that this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said and transmitted through his Prophet, or one of the great Sahaba transmitted through either their ijtihad. And we will study that. But what that was very well known in two main schools. In the school of Imam Malik radiallahu anhu and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. They were more towards al-Athar. And then the school of opinion. The school of opinion is more extrapolation. Like the school of Imam Abu Hanifa, who dependent, there is, I want you to look at that and understand, Quran and Sunnah are above everything. If there is a hadith, then no extrapolation is needed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يَرْمِي الْمُؤْمِنَاتِ الْمُحْصَنَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَأْتِ بِأَرْبَعَةِ شُهَدَاءٍ etc. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a ruling about qadhif, then there is no opinion about that. Nobody would give an opinion. That is not valid. But these are the things that are not obvious in the Qur'an or the Sunnah. They are not well defined in the Qur'an or the Sunnah. Some wanted, some like Imam Malik or Imam Ahmad, he will take Hadith Ahad, which is transmitted by one Sahabi over one Tabi'i, over his opinion. Imam Abu Hanifa would take an opinion and qiyas and comparison to other things over a weak Hadith. Over a weak Hadith. So that's where the differences are, and we will go about the differences in more details. But these are the first two, the division why these schools started coming apart. So Imam Abu Hanifa was more of the school of Ar-Ra'i. And we spoke about examples with his meetings with Muhammad al-Baqir, etc. when we are studying the life of Imam Abu Hanifa. And then Imam al-Shafi'i came to be really in the middle school. And he had the old school of al-Shafi'i and the new school of al-Shafi'i. And Shafi'i was a great organizer, radiallahu anhu. He really put a lot of good principles, and he organized both schools. He had opinions about al-Athar, and he had opinions about the school of opinion. And he put rules, and he put measures about how to take this and how to take that. And this is just to give you a general idea about what we will be talking about. But inshallah, we will go into that in a little bit more detail. And I hope I won't bore you with all of that. But then that's when the fuqaha started coming up. And that's when the age of imam started coming into existence. And that's what we have started studying when we studied the life of Imam Abu Hanifa. So that was the historical perspective. So who is an imam? Who is a faqih? Who is a mujtahid? Al-imam huwa al-mujtahid alladhi hasala lahu min al-ilmi wal-ma'rifah والملكات الذهنية والعقلية قدرة يستطيع بها أن يستنبط الأحكام. The definition of a mujtahid or a faqih or an imam is the one who can give, who is able to give rulings and extrapolate ruling based on knowledge, علم ومعرفة. He has to have great, strong knowledge. وملكات ذهنية. He has to have great intellect. Not everybody has, even if they memorize all the Quran, memorize all the hadith, but the ability to go into it and extrapolate, that doesn't happen to everybody. And to that, I would like to give you a small example. There is a hadith from the Prophet ﷺ that he passed by a little boy who was an orphan, who was actually brother of the great Sahabi, Anas ibn Malik. And the boy nickname was Abu Umair. And Abu Umair had a little bird he called Al-Mughayr. And that bird died. And this pet, the pet of Abu Umair, died. And Abu Umair was crying. This little boy was crying. So the Prophet ﷺ passed by him. And he patted on his hair. And he calmed him down. And he said, Ya Abu Umair, ma fa'ala al-Nughayr? Oh Abu Umair, what happened to the Nughayr? Now this is a hadith. Imam al-Shafi'i, radiallahu anhu, he studied this hadith and he extrapolated 99 rulings out of this hadith. He said, استخرجنا من هذا 99 حكما ونكتفي بهذا القدر تيمنا بأسماء الله الحسنى. He said, I will stop here just so it will be matching the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the 99. He extrapolated the number one you can give, you have to, if you have a child in distress, it is a sunnah to calm him down. And then patting on the hair of an orphan person. You can nickname a child. You can give a nickname like Abu Fulan, Abu etc. to a child. Then you can actually have a bird pet. You can hold the pet in a string or a cage. And you can name your pet. This is all rulings in Islam. And you can, many other things that somebody just had to have the brain and the intellect of somebody like Imam Shafi'i to understand all of that and extrapolate the rulings. So not only knowledge of that hadith. I mean, if you give a person hear that hadith, there's not really that many things that will start coming up to mind. But to somebody like the power of the mind of a Shafi'i, you see how many, many rulings he extrapolated from that. So that is a faqih. That is faqih. You have to have the knowledge and the ability to extrapolate. Then what is the madhab? The madhab in the Arabic language is a way, is a pathway, is something that would lead you to something else. That's what the madhab means. And it came to mean, in terminology, a school of thought, a school, a way of knowledge, a way of application of knowledge. And the word madhab has started to be used early on in Islamic history at the time of the Sahaba. And they would say madhab Aisha. This is this is the way of Aisha. And she was one of the great fuqaha, by the way. And she had contributed a lot to, radiallahu anha, to our knowledge and jurisprudence and understanding of our religion. And there was Madhab Abdullah ibn Umar, Madhab Abdullah ibn Abbas, Madhab Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And then later on, at Tabi'een, they had schools. But they were not really crystallized like we saw how they later on crystallized in the school of Abu Hanifa, Madhab Hanafi, Madhab Shafi'i, and etc. And the Tabi'een that had schools were Sa'id ibn Musayyib, Urwa ibn Zubayr, Al-Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, Nafi' Mawla Umar, the one that we said, this is the chain of gold, Ibrahim al-Nakhai, Hassan al-Basri, radiallahu anhu, Al-Sha'bi, Tawus ibn Kaysan, and we studied many of their lives when we were studying the lives of al-Tabi'een. Then they came about 13 schools, and that is called Madahib al-Mujtahideen. These schools were not only four of them. Now what we know of them, most of the surviving ones today are about eight. And there are actually 8 practiced madhab today. But the ones that are known mostly to be accepted by the majority of the scholars of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah are these 4 madhab. But to know, there were 13 of them at the time of al-Mujtahideen. There was madhab Sufyan ibn Uyayna, who was centered in Mecca. Malik, Imam Malik, and of course that is al-Madhab al-Maliki in al-Madinah. Al-Hasan al-Basri had his own madhab in al-Basra. Abu Hanifa, of course, Madhab Hanafi, he was settled in Al-Kufa. Sufyan al-Thawri was also in Al-Kufa. Imam al-Awza'i, he had a madhab and he was in al-Sham. Yes, of course. Imam al-Shafi'i in Egypt. Imam al-Layth, Madhab al-Layth, he was in Egypt as well. Ishaq ibn Rahway, he was in Naysabur. And there were 4 in Baghdad. 4 in Baghdad. Abu Thawr, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Dawood al-Zahiri, and by the way, Madhab al-Zahiri is still practiced today. It's not very common, but it's still practiced. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari was also in Baghdad. So that's how the school of thought started springing up. And the scholars, they started dividing who, there are levels. These are not all fuqaha are created equal, not all imams are created equals. And there are different ranks, there are different stations. And they, most of the books and the reference in that was the al-fuqh al-islami wa adillatu from the book of Az-Zuhayli. So they're mostly, the scholars have agreed on 6 different layers of imams, of fuqaha, of somebody who can actually transmit a ruling to you. So not everyone, you go and ask a question and they can give you an answer. They have to belong to one of these 6 layers. And it is important, and the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam emphasized the importance and the danger of this matter. When he, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would send an army to a place, this is what he would tell the commanders of those armies. He said, إِذَا حَصَرْتَ حِصْنًا فَأَرَادُوكَ أَن تُنزِلَهُمْ عَلَىٰ حُكْمِ اللَّهِ. He said, if you besiege something and they want to surrender to you and they say, give us the ruling of Allah, do in us the ruling of the Lord of Allah. He said, لَا تُنزِلْهُمْ عَلَىٰ حُكْمِ اللَّهِ وَلَكِنْ أَنزِلْهُمْ عَلَىٰ حُكْمِكَ فَإِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي أَتُصِيبَ حُكْمَ اللَّهِ فِيهِمْ أَمْ لَا. He said, the Prophet ﷺ, don't tell them this is the ruling of Allah if you don't know. Tell them it is my ruling, you know, give it to you. Because you don't know if you are actually executing the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not. So not everyone can actually, you shouldn't go to everyone and ask for a ruling. And so don't trap him. Don't trap your Muslim brother and let them tell you things that they're not sure of. And then not everybody should really be at leisure of giving a ruling. So who are these layers? And I will go over them fairly quickly, but just to understand who is who and who can do what. And you will see that great names in our Islamic history, they go down to 4 and 5. And these are, you know, you may say this is down the list, but this is still, these are very rare, very rare ranks. Number one, the highest layer, is what is called al-mujtahidul mustaqil al-mutlaq. What the Sahaba said, al-mujtahid, al-mustaqil al-mutlaq. And I try to translate this as an independent and absolute imam. But what does it mean? This is somebody who actually puts the rules and the methods of extrapolation. It's not somebody who is extrapolating based on rules. He actually making the rules, making sure that these are the rules of extrapolation. And we will see how they actually came up with that. Like for example, the hadith of Umar, when he told Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, take similarities and bring comparisons. They took that as this is a principle of qiyas. And that's how the imams like Imam Abu Hanifa took the qiyas as a source of jurisprudence. But these are people that can actually put rules. And these are basically the names that we just mentioned. And of them, the most famous today is Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi'i, and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And this layer does not exist anymore. This group of people do not exist anymore. The ones that put the methods and the rules of jurisprudence. The second layer after that is something called al-mujtahid al-ghair al-mustaqil. Al-mujtahid al-ghair al-mustaqil al-mutlaq, which is a dependent extrapolator. What does that mean? These are people who do not put the rules. They have the rules put to them by the greater imams, but they take the rules and they can extrapolate new rulings. Like who? Like, for example, Abu Yusuf, the student of Imam Hanifa, he came up with many new rulings based on the methodology of Imam Abu Hanifa. Based on what Abu Hanifa gave him as a rule of thumb, this is how you do this, this is al-Qaeda, this is the rule, then he would extrapolate new rulings based on those methods. So they are dependent on that school. Like Muhammad and Zafar al-Akhiri. The third layer, it's called a bound extrapolator, or al-mujtahid al-muqayyad. Who is al-mujtahid al-muqayyad? It is somebody who will give a ruling based on a certain school and a certain method, like the layer above them, like al-mujtahid al-ghair al-mustaqil al-mutlaq, but they do not deviate from the layers above them, from the two layers above them. There is any contradiction or anything, they don't take their opinion. What is the difference between this third layer and the second layer? The second layer, they saw, like the mujtahid al-ghair al-mustaqil al-mutlaq, they will take the rule of Abu Hanifa, for example, and this is just for just an example, and they can actually come with a ruling different from the rule of Abu Hanifa himself, based on his method. You understand the difference? But the third layer, they will not contradict. They cannot. They will come up with something. There's something new, but they will not contradict any of the two layers above them. And of them, Imam al-Tahawi, Imam al-Sarkhasi, and Imam Abu Nasr. Then the fourth layer is Mujtahid al-Tarjih. This is an Imam who takes evidence and weighs the evidence against each other. He's an evidence-weighing expert, so if you will. Imam al-Tarjih. And that is the fourth layer of fatwa. And they will take, for example, the opinion of Abu Yusuf and the opinion of al-Sarkhasi and opinion of Malik, and they have the ability to study them. And they say, well, this Imam had more weight of evidence in his opinion, so we prefer him. And this is what's called Imam al-Tarjih. يُرَجِّحُ رَأِي عَلَى رَأِي آخَرٍ. They don't come up with anything new, but they weigh the evidence and they prefer one opinion over the other. The fifth layer, it is somebody who is a fatwa transmitting expert. Their role in the fatwa world is they have the ability to transmit the fatwa from one layer to the other. They are teachers of Sharia. They are great professors of jurisprudence. And of them, like Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. These are great, you know, scholars in Islam. Don't be disturbed that we're putting them in layers. It's just the role. It's what they do. And they have the ability to understand and learn the madhab in great depth and be able to transmit the fatwa, transmit this to their students. And then the last one, which is the most common in today's world, but still, you have to understand, these are rare. The people that actually have that depth of understanding, there's not that many of them in the Muslim world, not even today. It's what's called al-muqallid, the followers. They are students of these great teachers who are mujtahidun al-fatawa. They learn and they transmit the fatawa to others. They transmit the ruling to other. And they don't have the ability to say, reject the opinion of, let's say, Abu Yusuf, or reject the opinion of Malik and take the... They will say, this is what Malik says, this is what Abu Hanifa says, and this is what al-Shafi'i says. And these are scholars. These are people that know what they're talking about. Don't think that this, you know, that puts them... But they don't tell you, you know, and they may have a personal opinion. They say, Wallahu a'lam, this may be better, but they give you... They don't say, I think Abu Hanifa was wrong and Shafi'i was right. They say, no, this is my preference. But this is the opinion of all three scholars. And I just wanted just to get you familiar with that terminology and how the scholars were divided. Why are there differences in schools? Why are there so many schools? Isn't it one religion? Isn't it one source? Don't we have one book, one prophet? How come we have all of these schools and all of these layers and all of this and Imam Awza'i and Imam Shafi'i and Imam Layth and etc.? There are many things that actually brought about the schools of jurisprudence. And just wanted to bring the three main issues about why the imams had to differ and how things happened so they differed with each other. Number one, there are differences of understanding and interpretation of the text. Let me give you an example. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, من صام رمضان ثم أتبعه ستا من شوال فكأنما صام الدهر كله. Whoever fasted Ramadan and followed it with six from Shawwal, as if he fasted the whole year. We all know this hadith. Now this min, صام ستا من شوال, this from can mean two things. Either 6 days of the month of Shawwal, within the month of Shawwal, or it can mean 6 days starting with Shawwal till the end of the year, till you come to the next Ramadan. And Imam Malik, the Madhab al-Maliki says, you have the whole year to fast these 6 days, based on that understanding. And it means that. In the Arabic language, you can interpret it either way. While Jumhur al-Ulama, the majority of ulama, said, no, you do it within the month of Shawwal. But it's actually a correct and true understanding of the meanings of the words. And people have different understanding of the very same text that they get. And that's one of the reasons that cause differences among schools. The other thing is differences in transmission and authenticity of textual resources. Meaning, if one imam gets this hadith on a mutawatir way, on a repetitive, authenticated way, then this hadith weighs a lot. You cannot contradict this hadith. The same hadith may reach another imam, and there is a break in the lineage. There is a weakness in there. So they consider it a hadith da'if, based on their knowledge, based on what they were told, based on the way that hadith transmitted to them. So they may go to other source of ruling other than this hadith, which they consider da'if. So since there was not a lot of writings, not a lot of books that are written, the authentication was not all the same, and there were differences in the transmission and the authentication of the hadith, there were some differences within these schools. The other thing is their use of the secondary sources of jurisprudence. What are the secondary sources of jurisprudence? I just want to leave you with this, and we will go over these sources, inshallah, in more detail next session. And then we will start breaking down the differences as we go over one imam after the other. One imam, we will talk, inshallah, after that about the school of Imam Abu Hanifa and what was his school, why he depended on this and that. And then as we study the life of each imam, now we have a better understanding about how they differed and why they differed. The first source of jurisprudence is Quran, as the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, they had some differences about how they used some verses, and we will go from there. But there is no disagreement that this is the highest source of jurisprudence. This is, if you want to be a faqih, you have to know your Quran very well. And you have to know the interpretation, you have to know the tafsir, you have to know asbab al-nuzul, you have to know how this each verse was revealed, because that is your book. That is your source. The second one was the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no doubt. And the sunnah are different things. The sunnah, not only hadith, the sunnah, not only what the Prophet ﷺ said, and that by itself divided into many different things. Hadith is, not all hadith were transmitted equally. There are some hadith that are more authenticated than others. There is a hadith mutawatir, there is a hadith ahad, there is hadith mashhur, famous, there is hadith munqati, mursal. We will talk about that inshallah. But then the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ are things that the Prophet ﷺ said, things that the Prophet ﷺ did. Something he didn't say anything about, but he did, and the Sahaba saw him doing that. صَلُّوا كَمَا رَأَيْتُمُونِي أُصَلِّي. Pray like you saw me praying, right? Make salah like you see me praying. And this is how the Sahaba transmitted. The Prophet never said, when you stand up, do this, and when you... This is the Sahaba that described the prayer of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't do, but asked other people to do. And that is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There are things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw that it was done, and he didn't say don't do it. Right? This is ما سكت عنه وقرّه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. There are things that he saw what was happening, and he said good, do it. It's a good thing, right? And there are things that he saw was done, And he didn't say anything. He didn't say, don't do it. So that is also, rulings are being taken from that. And there are things that he saw being done and he prevented it from happening. So this is the what all encompasses in the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. Another source of jurisprudence is what the Sahaba said. Qawl al-Sahabi, the fatwa of the Sahabi. And then, and to a lesser extent, fatwa tabi'i. And they're really interconnected. Because Al-Hasan al-Basri, who is a tabi'i, he would give hadith and he would say, on the Prophet, on the authority of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he doesn't say who gave him this hadith. And then later on his students said, Imam Hassan, you're giving us this hadith and we hear it from you and you say the Prophet said so, but you were never with the Prophet, so this is hadith mursal. He said, I won't say it unless I hear it from at least 70 sahabi. I would not have said that. When I say the Prophet said, that means I know exactly that he said it from 70 sahabi. But when I said, حَدَّثَنِي فُلَانْ عَنْ الرَّسُولِ, then that is the only person that told me about it. So he, to him, the hadith al-mursal was actually stronger than the hadith al-musnad. And so we have to understand also the fuqah of the tabi'een and how they understood and how they transmitted the hadith. Another source is agreement, al-ijma'. When the ummah, the ulama, the scholars of the ummah agree on a certain ruling, then that becomes a hujjah, that becomes a dalil, that becomes an evidence that this is the way it should happen. We will talk about all of that, inshallah, next session. Then al-qiyas, comparison. If something happened that is similar to something else that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or his sahaba did, then they take it and make that a ruling. And that is also one a source of jurisprudence. Then, especially for Imam Malik. Imam Malik took the practice in Medina. What do the people of Medina do? And his teacher was Rabi'at al-Ra'i, one of the great tabi'een. And Rabi'ah would say, when they say, why are you taking this as an evidence when you have a hadith? And he said, أَلْفٌ عَنْ أَلْفْ خَيْرٌ مِّنْ وَاحِدٍ عَنْ وَاحِدٍ. He said, the Medina, there were thousands of the Sahaba, and a thousand upon thousand is better than حَدَّثَنِي told me one upon somebody upon somebody else. And that's why they took that as a source of jurisprudence, and you will see that in the Madhhab al-Maliki. Another thing is something called al-istihsan. Istihsan, something that is preferred and preferred by the one that is giving the ruling, even if it contradicts qiyas, but it's preferred by that for a certain reason, and we will go over that inshallah. There's really no time today, but just want to just lineate that for y'all. And then the other thing, something called al-urf, common practice in a society. Common practice that is not against Islam, not against any ruling in Islam, can be taken as a ruling. For example, you cannot sell something in Islam that you don't own, or you don't have. But let's say you have a factory of shirts, and I come to you and I say, I want to contract you for 1,000 shirts. Here's the money for it. That is urf. This happens all the time. This is contracts, right? And this is not from the ruling of Islam, but based on istihsan, based on uruf, because it's a common practice, then that is one of the things that is also allowed. And now I'm getting nervous, Brother Jesse is here, so can't talk too much about that. And then another source of sharia is sadd al-dhara'i'. Sadd al-dhara'i'. And the best probably translation I can come with is prevention of vice. Things that would lead to something else, even if there is no text in hadith or a Quran that is clear to say this is haram, but because it can potentially lead to something bad, then it becomes haram. For example, and this is just based on example, don't take that. Like somebody said, I will go and take this sister and teach her Quran alone in the house, for example. Okay, right? Teaching Quran is not haram, right? But it can lead to a problem. And from the ruling of Sadd al-Dhara'i', from this particular source of jurisprudence, this becomes haram. Teaching Quran in that circumstances becomes haram. Am I doing fine so far? Then I would stop with that. Al-Masalih al-Mursalah, general benefit. If there is general benefit for the Muslims, that becomes a source. We remember that there are goals for the Sharia. حفظ المال, حفظ العقل, حفظ الحياة, the preservation of life, preservation of procreation, preservation of intellect. If there is general benefit for Muslims, مصالح مرسلة, then of course if there is no text, if there is no qiyas, if there is no ijma', then that becomes also a source of jurisprudence. And I felt that this introduction, just ABCs to jurisprudence, will help us understand the differences between the four schools as we go through the lives of the four imam. I apologize for taking more time than I should, and inshallah we will break for Salat al-Isha. Subhanaka Rabbil Izzati Amma Yasifoon, wa salamun ala al-mursaleen, walhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.